Thank you all for tuning in today. We're excited that you're interested in learning more about community education and the AHA. This training will help you understand more about heart valves, their importance, and what to look for. We will also discuss ways to get involved as a volunteer, becoming a champion of heart valve disease education, and the importance of volunteering. The AHA's mission is to be a relentless force for a world of longer, healthier lives. We aim to prevent disease, educate those living with a condition on ways to manage their condition, treatment options, as well as self-care. Heart valve disease impacts people all around the world. Early diagnosis, management, and treatment is critical to living longer, healthier lives. So let's discuss the impact. Heart valve disease affects approximately 5 million Americans each year, and this number continues to rise as the population ages. Patients with severe, untreated valve disease are at a risk for developing heart failure or of having a stroke. Incidence increases as you get older, but it can also impact those that have had rheumatic fever or have been treated for other illnesses and infections. Let's talk about why heart valves are important. The main function of heart valves are to regulate and prevent the backflow of blood. There are four main valves in the heart. The tricuspid valve regulates blood flow between the right atrium and the right ventricle. The pulmonary valve, which regulates blood flow from the right ventricle and the lungs, where it will receive oxygen. The mitral valve regulates blood flow between the left atrium and the left ventricle. The aortic valve regulates the oxygen-rich blood from the left ventricle to the rest of the body. The valve should be properly formed and flexible, should open all the way so that the right amount of blood can pass through, and should close tightly so that no blood leaks back into the chamber. The causes of valve problems can often be linked to birth abnormalities related to age or brought on by another condition. Age-related incidents can usually be classified into two categories. Degenerative valve disease, most commonly affecting the mitral valve. Over time, valves can slowly degenerate. For example, mitral valve prolapse, a condition that affects nearly 2% of the general population, may eventually turn into mitral valve regurgitation, requiring treatment. Calcification due to aging. Sometimes calcium can accumulate on the heart's valves, most commonly affecting the aortic valve, and can lead to aortic stenosis. Related illnesses and conditions that can cause valve problems. Mediastinal radiation therapy, or radiation to the chest. Survivors of childhood cancer who had radiation therapy have an increased prevalence of valve disease later in life. Infective endocarditis, injury, or rheumatic fever. These conditions can cause one or more of the heart valves to leak blood back into the heart chambers or fail to open fully, making your heart work harder and lessening its ability to pump blood. Although valve problems can potentially be severe and life-threatening, most valve conditions are also highly treatable. Signs and symptoms. Feeling tired can be a symptom of heart valve disease. And when this happens consistently, it's best to speak to a doctor or other healthcare professional about what's behind it. Other symptoms of heart valve disease include chest pain, shortness of breath, and lightheadedness. Many heart valve problems are first identified by the presence of a murmur or sound that can be heard when a healthcare professional listens to the heartbeat with a stethoscope. A murmur may sound like a whooshing noise of blood flowing through a valve that is narrowed or leaking. Some murmurs are harmless, and others can indicate an underlying problem with the valve. If a murmur is detected, a healthcare professional may be looking for the presence of a few valve problems, such as stenosis, or a narrowing or stiffening of the valve that prevents adequate blood supply from flowing through.
Regurgitation, when valves allow blood to flow backward into the chamber. Prolapse, a valve that has improperly closing leaflets. Atresia, a valve that is improperly formed or missing. When a murmur is detected by a healthcare professional, a careful evaluation will be needed to obtain an accurate diagnosis. Several tests can provide different types of information about heart valves and circulation. An echocardiogram, or echo, is a standard tool for assessing valvular heart disease. There are times when its effectiveness is limited in some patients. In addition to an echo, a stress test or exercise test can provide valuable information in patients with valvular heart disease. A healthcare professional may use an exercise test in combination with an echo or other tests to assess. Exercise testing helps evaluate changes in blood pressure, changes in symptoms, and the heart's response to a more challenging workload. If a heart murmur is present, the doctor will take note of any changes in the murmur that happened during exercise. Imaging is another way that professionals can diagnose heart valve problems. A chest X-ray shows the location, size, and shape of the heart, lungs, and the blood vessels. This image can provide initial basic information to the healthcare team because valve problems can sometimes change the shape of the heart. In addition, calcium deposits in the heart or on the valves may be visible on X-rays. A CT scan captures multiple X-ray images to create a cross-sectional image of the heart and lungs without having to puncture the skin to place catheters. A CT scan creates images of the valve anatomy and allows for evaluation of the severity of stenosis and regurgitation. A CT scan can also determine whether there are valvular lesions or nearby tumors affecting the function. An MRI is a non-invasive test that uses a magnetic field and radio frequency waves to create detailed pictures of organs and structures inside your body. Cardiac catheterization. Although cardiac catheterization is most often used to look at the blood flowing to the heart muscle, it also can provide important information concerning narrowed heart valves, leaky heart valves, or blood that is not flowing through the heart as it should. Let's talk about treatment. What are options for those living with heart valve disease? The news is good. There are several options for treatment, and some people live long, full lives with mild valvular problems and never require surgery. This is considered waiting and observing, but once a valve begins to affect the heart's ability to pump blood, it is likely to require some sort of intervention. Most valve conditions can't be treated with medication alone. However, sometimes the problem is not severe enough to require surgical repair, but it is bothersome enough to cause symptoms. Medications could reduce symptoms that accompany milder forms of valve disease, could help maintain heart rhythm if a related arrhythmia is present. Medications could reduce calcification in and around coronary arteries, or lower the risk of blood clots, which can lead to stroke. Valve repair preserves the patient's valve and leaflets. Sometimes repairs require a minor surgical procedure, and other times repairs need a more extensive surgery. Repair is most often possible for mitral valve regurgitation and tricuspid valve regurgitation. Valve replacement may include open heart surgery or a minimally invasive procedure such as TAVR or TAVI. Surgical options for valve replacement include a mechanical valve, which is a long-lasting valve made of durable materials, tissue valve, which may include human or animal donor tissue, Ross procedure, borrowing your healthy pulmonary valve and moving it into the position of the damaged aortic valve. The pulmonary valve is then replaced with a new valve. TAVR or TAVI procedure, transcatheter aortic valve implantation. This minimally invasive procedure is similar to placing a stent inside an artery. A catheter, a thin wire or tube, is threaded through an artery to the diseased valve, and then a new valve is placed inside the old valve. Some implanted valves are spring-loaded and expand themselves. Others are expanded using a balloon. Once the new valve is expanded, it pushes the old valve leaflets out of the way and the replacement valve takes over the job of regulating blood flow. The procedure chosen will depend on the valve that needs replacement, the severity of symptoms, and the risks of surgery. Some replacement valves require long-term medication to guard against blood clots.
Reviewing recovery milestones and lifestyle goals with your healthcare professional is critical to making the best treatment decision.
When a person is considering heart valve replacement or repair, it can be helpful to know the overall goals of the procedure and how your medical professionals will track the success and your return to wellness. Here are some of the likely goals for any valve surgery. Let's talk about ways to get involved and participate in your community. The American Heart Association depends on the time and talent of volunteers to help us create a healthier world free of heart disease and stroke. Volunteerism is at the core of what we do, and volunteers helping us create awareness of heart disease is critical to our mission. These are a few examples of ways you can make an impact. Most of our heart valve disease materials are available in both English and Spanish. We have a very comprehensive set of resources here for you to choose from. These resources can be printed and distributed or emailed. Advocating for change. We all have the power to make a difference by speaking out for policies that help build healthier communities and healthier lives. By joining You're the Cure, our online advocacy community, volunteers can begin taking actions to change communities and lives immediately. Our Action Center makes it easy to connect with local representatives to help inform legislative and regulatory policies locally and nationally. Visit yourthecure.org to register and visit the Action Center to learn more about current priorities. Become an empowered ambassador. Heart disease is the number one killer for all Americans, and stroke is also a leading cause of death. As frightening as those statistics are, the risks of getting those diseases are even higher for African Americans and Latinos. The American Heart Association needs ambassadors with creative, generous mindsets and leadership skills to help raise awareness about heart disease, stroke, and the importance of a healthy lifestyle. We're making progress, but still have much to do. If you're an activist, community leader, healthcare professional, young professional, or social entrepreneur who's helping lead the way through community-centered and culturally relevant solutions, we invite you to become an empowered ambassador. Support heart patients and caregivers. When someone experiences a cardiac event or stroke, the patient, their caregivers, and family members often feel alone in their experience. Our Support Network blog offers a place for volunteers who have experiences as a heart or stroke patient or caregiver to offer tips and insights. This opportunity allows volunteers to go beyond a medical story. They can share practical information in our online community, offering comfort and advice. Volunteers can submit posts as often as they would like. Next, you'll hear from an active volunteer for the AHA, Ray Rivera, and more about his journey to becoming a heart valve patient ambassador.
In 2016, I was diagnosed with AFib. That led to further investigation on how my heart was doing, and it turned out that I needed heart surgery. But once I had the heart surgery, I did what I was told and I got well quickly. And once I got well quickly, I understood the importance of taking care of your heart and that heart disease is not necessarily a death sentence. So I joined the Heart Association as a volunteer, thinking if people could hear my story, maybe it could change their lives. I think the most important qualities of a volunteer is they have to be willing to share their stories. They have to be willing to lead by example. Once I became a heart volunteer, I realized the importance of everything I told someone they needed to do, I needed to do, so I could show them that you could get better and you could get stronger and you could lead a normal life again. Some of the ways I get involved with the Heart Association are through going to their online support network and answering questions by people who are either getting ready for surgery, curious about post-surgery, how they're going to recover. I also make it known that I'm available to do interviews, to write stories, to share my experience about heart disease in any way that benefits the Heart Association. There's a tendency to believe that heart disease is a death sentence, but it's not. It's actually the opposite. You know, once we recover, it's an opportunity for us to become what we once were or what we never were. It's an opportunity to exercise and to seek new things in our life as we become a new person again.